What is an entrepreneur? How do we enable them in a off the record, off the books discussion about one of the efforts that NorCal is thinking about, which is creating a Peace Corps a NorCal incubator or accelerator or hub, some mechanism for enabling RPCVs with good ideas to get access to resources, capital, and help and support group for building enterprises for social good, both for-profit and non-profit. And so we were wanting to get your advice on that, and that'll be a round table. And if you want to grab lunch and bring it back, or hang out of here, it's totally up to you. I'll bring it to there. So I'm going to hand out the note cards, and then we'll start. All right, let me start with introductions. First, I'll give you a brief background. I am a RPCV from the Gambia, 2008. When I got into the country, I only have 40 things going on in my brain right now. When I got into the Gambia, the only access to technology training in the country was Word, Excel, PowerPoint, and leaving the country, so everybody who was smart enough left and never came back. So I got to build the first computer science major at the University of the Gambia, and it's now the third most popular major after law and medicine. And then in my day job in the US, I co-founded and raised about $1 million for a privacy technology company in 99. I ran that till 9/11 destroyed the market. I've done entrepreneurship for the last 10 years and consulting in Asia and worldwide and also in San Francisco. And spent in the last 15 years here, so I know a lot about those areas. Amy, who's at the end, served as a Peace Corps volunteer in Paraguay from 2009 to 2011. She has a master's degree in social entrepreneurship and management from the Middlebury Institute of International Studies in Monterey, California. If you've never been there, go. It's beautiful. Amy is the co-founder of, I'm going to say this wrong, Saludos, a health commerce social enterprise based in Santa Cruz. Amy has a knack for bringing diverse stakeholders to the table and is most enthusiastic about projects achieving local and global impact simultaneously, a difficult task. While Amy is not that well deep in social innovation work, you can find her at a music venue or trying to use street food. Kathleen, do you know
her?
Caitlin.
There's two. Is Kathleen another one or is that a title? So, Caitlin. I have both. Caitlin Nutter is the Assistant Director of Entrepreneurial Curriculum at the Center for Entrepreneurial Studies at Stanford University's Graduate School of Business, which is quite an impressive curriculum and location. She works with the faculty and lecturers to develop and execute the entrepreneurial curriculum, coaches graduate student entrepreneurs, and creates experiential learning opportunities around entrepreneurship and innovation, including assisting with Stanford's Venture Studio and Startup Garage programs. Prior to Stanford, Caitlin had previous experience coaching undergraduate students through the product development process, helping to run summer programs for high school students interested in entrepreneurship and social entrepreneurship, and co-founding a small company. She's also a returned Peace Corps volunteer, served 28 months in Ukraine, where she worked in youth development, providing life skills training, programs in reproductive health, HIV, AIDS, nutrition, and drug alcohol deterrence. She holds a master's in engineering and technical entrepreneurship from Lehigh University, as well as dual BA degrees in psychology and product design, and certificate of global citizens from Lehigh. And her interests include travel, mountain climbing, and camping in the 3 seconds that she has when she's not doing her work. And I don't have any products, so can
you? You have to
buy for it.
I don't have it. Do you want me to just give a quick
Following your form. Well, I have been, I was in the Peace Corps in Tunisia. My name is Cheryl Bolton, I'm sorry. And I was in the Peace Corps in Tunisia in the late 60s. I was there in 68 too. And we had this fabulous training thing at a dude ranch in Colorado before we were the first group that had in-country training. So we then went in-country and we had, it was tough. There on the Mediterranean, on the beach. at any rate, that it has influenced my life, no doubt about it, and I'm sure it's had a lot to do with my being an entrepreneur. So I've done a lot of different things. I've been a social entrepreneur, and I'm going to skip something and go ahead and define what I think a social entrepreneur is, which is, and then we can let everybody else jump in. I think it actually, there's a lot of controversy about the definition actually of social entrepreneur, because a lot of people think that it means a nonprofit doing good kind of thing. And actually, I think there's a big, pretty large spectrum. There's the triple bottom line, which a lot of you probably know about, which is people, planet, and profit, that other thing that helps you be sustainable as an entity. So I would say that social enterprise includes the entire spectrum of for-profit companies all the way to nonprofit companies, if you have the goal of social impact in addition to your other goals. And we can get into all the differences that I see. So what I've done with my life, I spent a few years as a senior administrator at a medical college. I have a master's in linguistics, undergraduate, you might have already guessed this, from the University of Georgia, where I grew up. And then I had never met an MBA, but decided I needed those skills, so I started applying to graduate school. And so I have a Harvard MBA, which was another cultural, intense cultural experience. I think somebody said that yesterday, and I would totally agree with that. And then from that point on, I've been in business. So I have had the nobody would touch me because I didn't fit. No headhunter would touch me because I didn't fit into anybody's track or anything. And I also had prematurely gray hair from the time I was about 20. So it was like I wasn't going to fit. So I managed to get a lot of different jobs because I wanted the skills, including investment banking at Merrill Lynch in New York, working in asset management, finance skills I wanted, working for the Rockefeller family, operations and marketing, sales for home box office. So it was great. And then I decided to become an entrepreneur. So for the last 20-something years, I've been CEO or have led various companies, startups, and two of them I've sold, one in healthcare, Physicians Online, to WebMD. I took one public, Scientific Learning Corporation, which is a neuroscience technology company that focuses on, it was one that started the whole training the brain thing, but training the brain to prepare to read, to understand language and read. And remember, I have a master's in linguistics. I never thought I'd find a job using that. I did. And since the last few years, I've advised companies from all over the world, startups and small companies that want to expand in the US from the Pacific Rim, from parts of Africa. Been back to Tunisia a couple of times. I'm going in July to speak at a conference of engineers, Tunisian engineers, who want to understand how to create an ecosystem in Tunisia to really foster entrepreneurship. I've been an investor when I was also at Merrill Lynch. So I've kind of run the gamut. I've had great advantages and opportunities, and a very interesting time of it. And I hope it doesn't stop. I don't see myself retiring. I'm involved right now in a very exciting pure startup, which I usually avoid because I think they're too risky. I like things that already have some cash to get things moving quickly. But it's all about how do you reduce the number by a significant percentage of massive strokes. So it's a healthcare software company, and I think it has incredible potential, so I'm excited for that. Plus the other zillion things going on. So, you want to talk about social entrepreneurship?
Yeah.
That's okay. You have quite the resume. So the question is, what is social entrepreneurship? How would you define it to this crowd?
So I work a lot with individuals who are very early on in entrepreneurship. And so for me, a social entrepreneur is someone who really puts that mission before the profit. So they're more concerned about making an impact for either an underserved community or environmental. And it's very important that that's first, because once they start to face challenges, if that's not first, they may change and use their solution to solve a slightly different problem that's going to generate more money. And so for me, a social entrepreneur is one who when they face those challenges, they're going to go back to their core mission and their core beliefs, and they're going to use that to guide them.
Amy?
When I first started looking into social entrepreneurship, I thought it was silly. I think everyone in here that probably has a business idea is probably just naturally a social entrepreneur. You automatically want to provide value. That is the purpose of any business. And I think all of us, if you ended up in the Peace Corps, social value is just kind of a given. If you want to put your efforts into something, I think that most of us here, that's just innately part of creating value. Of course, it's going to be social value. So I thought it was kind of weird that like we needed to create social entrepreneurship. Like, what, do you just create a business that wouldn't be providing social value? So I think, for me, I think it's a really buzzy topic and, you know, word and phrase and a lot of, like social return on investment and sorts of things are this hot topic right now. And I think it's really important, but I think it really is just about getting people to formally be committed to social value being added. So it probably isn't the clearest definition, but what you're gonna find in this realm of work is that there is no clear definition. So.
I'm going to my 35th Harvard Business School reunion this fall, and so I have been in every kind of business, as I just told you, you can kind of imagine, and had a lot of opportunities. And I think the number one thing for a business is to stay alive, because nobody can have any impact if you're not alive as a business. It has to be sustainable. So whether you have the tax structure of a nonprofit or a for-profit, you have to have revenues and you have to make a profit eventually after investment. So you have to see a path to doing that. And I think one of the things that sort of disturbs me is the emphasis on, although I think it's very important to have the social impact emphasis and the mission, it's equally important to have the business goals of being able to have sustainable revenues and profits. So I can't tell you how strong we are. I've seen it happen so many times where nobody gets to have any impact because the organization or the business doesn't succeed. It's not able to live on its own. So I think that's an important thing to remember.
Thank you. So I'll just chime in real quick. The way I'd like to explain this, companies prioritize value to the shareholder, social entrepreneur companies prioritize value to the individual or the customer, or the company that doesn't have money. But that's not generally an accepted definition, just to explain. So I guess my first question for you, thank you, is most people, when they think social entrepreneurship, think nonprofit, right? So do you feel like social entrepreneurship means that you can only build a nonprofit, or do you feel like there are profit ways to do it, and do you have any insight on C Corp versus B Corp? Does everybody know what a B Corp is? All right, so maybe you can give a quick example of what a B Corp is and then tell me.
I've done a little bit of research into B Corps, so I know some. B Corps is sort of a combination between a C Corp and a nonprofit. And as far as I can determine, it's all the bad parts of each one. but I'll just, that's my own opinion. I don't really see the reason for
it. Can you be a social entrepreneur and not do nonprofit?
Yes. My opinion, and a lot of other people's opinion about the difference between a nonprofit and a for-profit is, a nonprofit, you don't have equity, so there's not upside for you in that, a financial upside, so you're not able to increase the stake in the company and go public and all that kind of stuff. Otherwise, it's a tax structure, the difference, and that's kind of it. The tax structure has a lot of constraints around it that you have to adhere to be able to not have to pay taxes. But the whole idea is that this is a good idea, and so we're going to give you a break on the taxes so that you can reinvest that money in your business. That's the idea. Whereas the idea for C Corp is you're going to make a profit. There are a lot of ways not to pay taxes for C Corps too, and to reinvest in the business, by the way. But you do have that, you have the incentive that you can give the employees that there's upside in equity, and you also can decide at any time that you want to reinvest the proceeds that you've accumulated back into your business to grow it. The other difference is for C Corp, you have the ability to attract outside investment. So if you need $1 million or $50,000 or whatever you need to get going, you can get an outside investor because that investor has a chance at a return later at an ROI, or I don't want to use too many. He can make a profit himself or herself. The problem with a nonprofit organization is that you can only get charitable funds or donations. They don't get them back, but it's a whole lot harder to get them in the first place. And it's certainly more difficult, I think, or as difficult to get the sustainable flow of investment funds. I think the other thing in our country also is the psychology of the people who work at the organizations. There's a certain urgency in a for-profit C Corp because if you don't get it done, somebody else is going to get it done before you, especially if you're in Silicon Valley or in the Bay Area, but other areas too. So there's an urgency that sometimes, but not always, is missing in a for-profit structure because there's not that constant pounding on that occurs by investors. So in my opinion, I think it's a good thing if you're out, if you want to have a lot of social impact, for example, in healthcare, or as we did in neuroscience research to help reading, help kids read. We've helped millions and millions of people read better. That, to me, is a great goal. And I'm happy that we did it the way we did it because it included a lot of software development, takes money, a lot of distribution, takes a lot of money, and we couldn't have done it, I don't think, very rapidly at all, or if at all, with a not-for-profit. So remember, you've got not-for-profit with a lot of constraints, no equity, it's a tax structure. The B Corp, which combines both, which sounds like a good idea, but I can't figure out what's so great about it. And then the C Corp, which is, it's not pure profit motive, it's just a way to have investment and to give incentives to employees, basically, to grow the company.
The only thing I want to add to that is a lot of people I've talked to about B Corps have said that there's decades of law that has been about C Corps, and B Corps are so new that they don't know how the judges are going to rule, so it's a risk, especially to investors. So Caitlin, you're at Stanford, one of the best business schools in the world, I would argue. How would you see, or how do you see, the education differences between a traditional business program and a social entrepreneur business program at Stanford?
So early on, we try and keep a lot of the students together because a lot of the times they are very similar, and we don't want to force them to decide, make those decisions like, oh, am I a nonprofit, am I a for-profit, and am I a social venture? Very early on, you're just trying to solve a problem, essentially. And then as they continue on, we do notice that if they're in traditional entrepreneurship courses, they do face a lot of challenges. So things like when you start talking about unit economics, it isn't the same for social ventures. And so they really need, we have outside support for social ventures specifically because they need someone to kind of break down what it is. It's not that you can just ignore where you're getting revenue, it's just it's going to look a lot different.
Is marketing to get people to pay Stanford for a degree that is different from a traditional business one, and how much of it is actually curriculum difference?
Brutal!
Amy. This is the question I'm constantly getting about social entrepreneurship. Is it a marketing fad to sell more MBAs at a program that's traditional, or is there actually a difference in the program? And what you just said was interesting, which is the program is basically identical for some amount of time, and then there's a slight differentiation, but it's not black and white. It's not like going computers versus English.
Right, because so we believe that there's a fundamental process, you know, gaining empathy, understanding your user, prototyping, getting feedback, iterating, and so following that process is going to be the same whether or not you're in a social field, you're in education, you're in, we have companies that are doing just service-based businesses, we have high-tech, we have hardware, you're still following the same process.
So business is business.
Yeah, I just want to make one other comment about the different organizational, corporate organizational types. I'm on the board of an NGO, and I'm also a trustee of a college, and those are great examples of organizations that definitely should be not-for-profit because of what they do, and where they happen to be. The NGO works in developing economies and seeks the market for various activities. And they need partners that are willing to do that, and it needs to be non-for-profit. So I don't want to give the idea that everything is a fit with everything with the entire spectrum. Just think some things fit better than other things.
Amy, you're a self-declared social entrepreneur and have a company that you have described as a social enterprise. One of the questions I'm getting is, do you find that you have to justify yourself more, or that people come into it and think, oh, that's cute, and take you less seriously? Is there a negative to being a social entrepreneur in the business community that you have to defend against?
I think it really depends the audience. Solidus has been in different competitions to raise money, and some that are like Berkeley here has the Global Social Venture Competition, where the audience does want to see the social impact as a key metric versus I pitched a few weekends ago at the Monterey Bay Startup Challenge where people are very traditional business minded. People weren't wanting to hear the social impact metrics at all. I totally changed my pitch. They just wanted to hear bottom line. So it really depends on the audience and when you kind of wear which identity, knowing what's appropriate and what people are looking to hear. So that's my.
Comcast Berkeley, they're sort of a social company that they provide value to people.
That's a hard.
They're the worst. They're just the worst.
That's the official definition. All right, so some to the crowd. You guys have great, asked great questions. Let me start with one. Maybe you can tackle one, then you two can go. What's your opinion regarding crowdfunding as a social enterprise, and how's it different from crowdfunding or traditional enterprise?
Well, I'm just talking about crowdfunding first. There's a lot of crowd, it's called crowdfunding, but it actually is buying products in advance and getting a discount on those products. It turns out that you don't normally raise, it depends on what kind of business you want to start, because if you want a really big business, you think that your idea is going to be big or moderately big, crowdfunding may not be the way to start, because you have, first of all, the burden of actually delivering a product to all these people who bought it at a discount. And you may have seen in the paper recently that there was a company that folded and never delivered anything, and they're getting suits right and left all over the place. So you got to be sure you can deliver. Secondly, if you think you might have a company that has real legs and might grow rapidly and be moderately big, most institutional investors, like venture capital folks, and even larger angel investors, don't like to see 50 people as with the kind of equity in the company, because that means every time that a decision has to be made about the smallest thing.
What are the media and marketing differences between a traditional company and a social networking, I'm sorry, social entrepreneurship company? What are the things that you get as a benefit in terms of media and marketing by being a social entrepreneur that you don't normally get with a traditional company? Amy, maybe you could start.
I think that people that are social-minded investors are willing to not need a return on investment quite as quick as a traditional investor. So I think that's something that comes to mind
And is the education at Stanford different about marketing for traditional versus a social entrepreneur company?
I think it's easier for a social entrepreneur to tell a very good story, especially early stage marketing. You have to be able to tell your story very well and connect with other people. And sometimes that can be easier for social entrepreneurs because they're coming from a mission standpoint, so that's kind of built into their company.
From an investor standpoint, one of the questions I get asked a lot is, do investors actually discount you as being a social entrepreneur because you're less likely to bring an ROI? Would you be more or less receptive to a pitch coming from a social entrepreneur versus a traditional business person?
For me personally, I can recognize a good business idea, I think, and I can be helpful to an entrepreneur. But the things that I feel passionate about are always the things that have potential for social, for big impact. So I always like those things better. I don't really care what the names or the code names are for them. And to me, in some ways, if you have a sophisticated business person, they know, as you did, you changed your pitch depending on who you were talking to, and I think you have to be able to do that. And so some investors will really respond, and you find out as you're talking to people when you're making a pitch, you know, what is it that they really pick up on and like, and then you can expand on that. And a lot of times that's the impact, really. And so you don't have to call yourself a social entrepreneur in some cases.
So this is interesting, right? You hear from the entrepreneur that she changes her pitch dramatically. You hear from the education person that it's a slight difference. You hear from the investor that it's all of a sudden that she sees through regardless, right? So one of the things that this is bringing up, which is a great lead into this next question, is it's pretty clear that social entrepreneurship, quotes, right, means many things to many people. And I would argue it's also presented differently depending on the marketing and the messaging for a particular program or what have you. How important do you think it is that the industry, I guess by industry, people promoting social entrepreneurship come together around a common definition? Is it important that social entrepreneurs and education and investors, do we need a lexicon that is commonly agreed on with some social entrepreneurship by IEEE, you know, or W3C saying this is what it means to be one or not be one, or is it okay to leave it this flexible and fuzzy?
What do you mean by that? I've been to a number of social enterprise conferences, the Legato conference at MIT, Harvard has one, there's one here, I think they're all over the place. And I think, although you see, at the beginning, when they first started having them about 5 years ago, you saw predominantly not-for-profit organizations. Now you see everything, it's much more inclusive. So I think it's better to be able to pick the structure that's closest to what your goals are going to be.
Yeah. What are the funding source differences between a traditional entrepreneur and a social entrepreneur? Where do you look for money? Is it the same places or is it different places?
I think it's different, but people who are traditional investors also give to, like Cheryl's also on the nonprofit board or whatever. Certain stories will connect with certain individuals, but the impact investing world is growing, and that's a really good community to start in if you're a social entrepreneur, is people who are learning about impact investing, where they don't just care about a traditional return on investment money-wise, but they could get no financial return, and some people are okay with that as long as they're getting their social return. So, yeah, there are different communities, definitely.
As a funder, or someone who understands the funding space, where would a social entrepreneur look for money different from just traditional VCs? What recommendations would you have for the best place to get funded as a social entrepreneur?
Well, it comes back to the structure again. So a traditional VC is never going to invest in a not-for-profit, and the jury's still out in B Corp.
they're looking for C Corps, the traditional structure that's a Delaware corporation, et cetera, et cetera. However, having said that, if you have a C Corp and you also have a very large social impact mission that you're totally committed to with your company, there are many VCs who would be seen as rather traditional. Some of the larger VC organizations on Sentinel Road definitely invest in things that can improve humanity. That's one of the attractive attributes that you can bring to the party, that you understand this and that you've had this idea and these are the outcomes that you expect or that you've already begun to measure, and this can have a huge, wonderful effect. At Scientific Learning, when I went out to get money, we got, our VC was Warburg Pincus. It's one of the most traditional, largest venture capital firms in the world, probably at that time, out of New York. And they were very interested in figuring out how to make better readers. So it really depends on not on the firm as a whole, but on the person that you find in the firm that's willing to go to bat for you and be your translator about why this is so important to his or her colleagues. That's very important. So it's hard to just make a blanket statement. There are lots of people like Peace Corps, return Peace Corps volunteers who want to continue to have strong impact in a very positive way. They just happen. In fact, we heard from one yesterday who is an investment banker and who wants to have impact. So there are a lot of people around who have to, by word of mouth or meeting with their colleagues, have to find out who they are, so there's a lot of homework. Let me just say, a not-for-profit, you don't go there. You have to go to either government agencies or the charitable philanthropic group.
What one or two key things do you think were the most surprising for you to learn about social entrepreneurship from when you thought you would go into it to where you are now? What surprised you the most?
I think a surprising thing, which I think can be applied to entrepreneurship or social entrepreneurship, was don't be competitive. Talk to your competitors, share ideas, learn from them. You kind of, like, if you have your really good idea, you wanted to protect it in the beginning. Throw that out the window and talk to your competitors, and you'll end up helping each other out. And ultimately, as a social entrepreneur, you should care about impact. Whether I do it or you do it, just somebody get it done. So that was, I think, a surprising thing was how much the competitors are talking to each other. Another surprising thing is maybe just the people, that you find in the industry or just in this world. Everybody has very different backgrounds. You have a master's in linguistics and ended up in investment. And oftentimes you can connect with people on levels that, I don't know, even kind of like Peace Corps, you think everyone's going to be the granola eating hippie. And then you get there and it's like, student council president and all these overachievers also. So surprising thing is, the different people that you end up working with and their backgrounds are from everywhere.
Why not be both? I didn't want to be a student council hippie. For Stanford, what would you say in the education is most surprising to the students that they didn't realize or didn't think about when they were coming into social entrepreneurship?
How sometimes hard it is. So, for example, something like energy. How do we solve this problem? We need to figure it out. But you know what? A lot of individual consumers might not care about energy. And so, how do you find those people who care about energy and find out who your customer is? You can be very passionate about a problem, but it's still very difficult to solve, and that passion only takes you so far.
As I know you have multiple hats in here, but I keep coming back to you as the investor because we have that fun. From an investment perspective, what do you think is the most surprising
surprising thing or the most important thing that a social entrepreneur should know or have in their 60-second elevator pitch or on their one-paragraph executive summary in order to pitch to an investor a social entrepreneurship idea?
That sounds way too hard. I'm sorry. The one thing. Well, I pretty much think, I'll tell you in general, I think that you really have to know your customer. And you have to think like your customer, and you have to have something that is of high value for your customer. And then you have to test it out to see if your customer is actually going to buy this, or use it, or both, hopefully. And then you have to measure the outcomes and find out that they really did use it, and that they really did, or they not just bought it, but they really did use it, and it did make a significant difference. And that's why elevator speeches are so hard, because you have to get all that in there.
Tell me about it. How many times have I practiced that elevator speech? So I just want to end with distilling down some of my key takeaways. So the thing I learned most from Amy was that as a social entrepreneur, it's a lot harder than just being a regular entrepreneur, because you have a lot more inputs, and that it's difficult on a number of dimensions that aren't necessarily obvious. Thing I learned from Caitlin, and I appreciate you bringing up with me, is that it's not just a marketing spin, that there is a difference, and that it is a different set of education. There's a lot of overlap with traditional business, and then also a lot of difference. And I think that's one of the reasons why it's so hard to put a definition on it, is because it lives in these multiple spaces. It isn't just a thing. It has a lot of history in it. And then from the investment standpoint, I think you've made it very clear to me, at least, that it doesn't matter what you call it. If you don't have core business fundamentals, investors aren't interested anyway. And that it's much more important to have the right business model and the right business formation than it is to have the right social entrepreneurship keywords in an elevator pitch or in an executive summary. So before I thank our panelists, I just want to add one last pitch for our lunchtime session, which. And please come up and ask us questions if you want. There is obviously a difficulty in social entrepreneurship that is slightly different or very different depending on where it is from traditional business. And one of the things that NorCal Peace Corps Association is working on right now, and with the help of some of these people, is how do we catalyze not just social entrepreneurship, but the unique capabilities and needs of RPCVs with social entrepreneurship. This is more than just having a good idea. This is having a good idea with 2 years of in-country cultural linguistic experience that makes RPCVs uniquely talented and capable social entrepreneurs. And what can NorCal, the organization, do? And what can we do to create sort of a location or a nexus, or to use the keywords, a hub or an incubator or accelerator, to focus specifically on RPCVs cross social entrepreneurs? And that's what we're working on next is NorCal for this next 4 to 6 months. If you'd like to be part of that conversation, we'd love to have you. I would really like to thank all of you for your time. Thank you for your investment advice. It's been brilliant. Thank you for putting up with me. I really wanted to challenge you because I have been challenged on the MBAs. I didn't do it to attack you. I did it to make the point that this is the problem with MBAs right now. And so thank you for being on this, and thank you for being a social entrepreneur, and you're an inspiration. So thank you. If you want to get food and come back, if you want to sit and go get food, if you just want to leave, all of you.